All right, my friends, we're going to get started now. I'd like to welcome everyone. My name is George Peralta. I'm the jewelry manager at M.S. Rau. And this is the latest episode of our Bourbon with Bill series. If you're joining us for the first time, thank you for being here. This series started about 3 years ago. It was a way for us to connect with our clients. And it continues today, literally as a fun-filled hour, where we discuss a diverse array of topics among art, antiques, and jewelry. You can catch up on any past episodes on our M.S. Rau's YouTube page. During our last webinar, we looked at pieces with important provenance. I definitely recommend that you check that video out on our YouTube page. And I want to remind you that tonight's webinar is all about interaction. So feel free to ask any questions that come to mind throughout the webinar. You can use the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. We're here to educate and engage, so do not be shy. This, again, I mentioned, will last a full hour. We'll try to answer as many questions throughout the webinar, but we will also have a dedicated Q&A section at the end. Before we get started, I'd like to make an exciting announcement. M.S. Rau's next exhibition is going to be Arte and the Era of Art Deco. It will open in about 2 weeks, and this may be my favorite one yet. The exhibit presents a curated collection of over 160 paintings by Arte, considered the father of Art Deco, along with objects of art, jewelry, and furniture of that period, which is a favorite of ours here. If you can't make it to the gallery, be sure to check up and stay in touch with us via our information online or through our social media. We'll be posting information about it afterwards. But I'm excited to get started tonight. As I mentioned, we are focusing on top museum quality treasures. I'd like to welcome Bill Rau, the CEO of M.S. Rau, onto the webinar. Welcome, Bill.
Thank you very much, George. I'm glad to be here.
All right, your microphone is working, so all is well in the digital world. We're going to kick things off, but Bill, since I mentioned that Arte exhibition, would you mind sharing with everyone on the webinar a little bit about it and your vision for it? And then we're going to jump into the museum quality treasures, and you have to tell us how you were able to narrow down to this selection.
Well, let's start with Arte. About a year ago, we came across this the best collection of Arte original drawings ever assembled. Over 160 of them, each one different, each one done for, whether they were done for theater, whether they were done for magazines, just one better than the next. And it took a long time to close the deal. We ended up acquiring all of them. And this was the nucleus. Arte was the father of Art Deco. And this is the best collection there is. Imagine 160 different works. And what I like about them, the prices are very attainable. They're not, the prices in the webinar today of many of the things are less attainable, not all of them, but these are all very attainable prices. And I think the most expensive Arte might be $45,000. And then there are many, many far, far cheaper. And each one is stunningly beautiful. And then we took that and got we've been working for a year now, building up an extraordinary collection of Art Deco jewelry and other Art Deco objects that are going to make the exhibition really wonderful.
All right, I'm very excited for that. I love that period, especially in the jewelry portion of our gallery. Okay, so the museum quality treasures, the theme of tonight's webinar. How are you able to, I mean, how do you, it's like choosing your favorite child, I guess. How are you able to narrow it down to this selection?
Well, so I think the term museum quality is often overused. I mean, I've been to many places, well, this is museum quality. Mm-hmm. We decided to take it a little bit different, and you'll see during the webinar, we didn't pick pieces that are just, some I would call museum quality. Every piece we picked has something extraordinarily close related to it, in a museum, in a major museum, not in, you know, in a museum in, you know, downtown small city in Peru, but, you know, but major museums. And so our pieces that we're about to show you are, to say their museum quality is somewhat of an understatement. They're brothers and sisters are in museums.
That's great. Okay, well, let's kick it off. The very first one may be a name that many people recognize, maybe even a household. Vincent, this painting is by Vincent van Gogh. So Bill, kick us off with this first museum quality treasure.
Well, certainly. So Van Gogh is in every single list of most important artists ever that painted in the Western world, in the top 10, and for many, he's number one. He really changed art. He was the change between academic and modern art. He only painted for roughly 9 years, and his paintings were extraordinarily rare. This is from a really important period when he went to Noonan, Holland. This is where he was from. He wanted to paint the people that he grew up with. Van Gogh was extraordinarily poor. He felt a kin spirit with these other poor people. He didn't paint the bourgeoisie. He painted people just like himself. This headdress that she's wearing is a normal headdress. It was the uniform, quote unquote, of a Noonan woman in the 1880s. Let's show a close up of it next. Look at the brush strokes of it. Now, this looks, when you look very close, it looks a little bit weird, like, because you see the brush strokes. When you step a little bit back from it, it appears that this is how the light's hitting her face. He actually not only used, you know, a paintbrush, he would use his thumb to put paint on. He would create these wonderful feels that made you feel like that the person was alive. If you notice, the woman is looking at you. If you're capable, whether you're on a computer or whether you're on an iPhone, if you're capable of moving a little bit to the left and right, you'll see she's still looking at you. This was something that Van Gogh really just nailed better than everybody else. Now, when we talk about examples that are, you know, this is a museum example, let's show some of the other ones that are in museums, because he painted about, I want to say, 9 of these. Here's one in the Van Gogh Museum, very similar. Here's another one in the Van Gogh Museum, very similar, not near as great as ours. Here's one in the museum in the town where he's from in the Netherlands, also very similar to ours. Here's one in the National Gallery of Scotland. Here's one in a place called the Met, a little bit different of a feel because it's side view, but not, you know, profile, not straight on, but you can still see the sail and nice heaven in the Met. And then we go back to ours. Ours is also a super piece. There's only 2 in store in private hands, and the other one, ironically enough, sold about 6 months ago at Sotheby's in London, and it sold to a dealer by the name of Danny Katz, and it sold for about 20% more than we're asking for ours. So we know ours is a good value, and it's just a great painting. And there's just so few Van Goghs in private hands. I mean, he only painted, I think, 600 paintings, and the great majority of those in museums. So there's just a handful in private hands. So to be able to get a Van Gogh oil like this is so rare.
Bill, as I knew, Van Gogh would elicit many questions on it. So I did want to pull this one out from the questions that were asked. Was this a popular painting style of Van Gogh? I'm assuming they're asking that because, you know, his famous one, Starry Night, and the sky and colorful, and this is a little bit more with earth tones.
So Van Gogh, this is where Van Gogh, where he really got his feel when he was in Noonan. This is a really important period of his time. So Van Gogh would go through periods, and this period this is the same period. One of his greatest masterpieces is considered the Potato Eaters. And this is from the exact same period as the potato. I mean, the exact same, painted in the same town at the same time. So this is really it's an exact point of when Van Gogh, I would say, got his style. But it's different than Starry Night. It's completely different. Would I rather have Starry Night? I won't lie. I will say yes. I mean, Starry Night might be worth 300 million, and this might be worth, you could take off quite a few zeros and, you know, on that number, for this one. Having said that, owning any Van Gogh is extraordinarily rare, and we're never going to own Starry Night, despite, you know, because I doubt the Met's going to let go of it.
Absolutely. Thank you, Bill. Just a great one to start off with, literally in so many museums and a recognizable name. The next painting that we're going to have for tonight's webinar is this one by Henri Matisse. Again, a recognizable name in many museums. And everybody must have caught on from that very first one with the Van Gogh, just kind of how you're going to really, truly prove museum quality through this. So share with us your insight on this painting by Henri Matisse.
So this one really excites me a lot, and I'll share why. First of all, I've been trying to buy it for 14 years. 14 years ago, it was in a museum exhibition. I saw it, and I met the people that owned it, who happened to be direct descendants of Henri Matisse. And they were telling me about it, how this had never, ever been on the market. It stayed in the family, yet it had been in, 14 different museum exhibitions. Pretty darn good. And it was in, pictured in 13 different books. That's rather amazing. Matisse loved this painting. So every really very famous person had that moment that they changed from semi-famous to famous, or from famous to super famous. And I would also put that the artist Matisse in the top 10 artists of all time in Western art. So what changed Matisse from being really famous to being like a superstar? And that was in 1951, MoMA, Museum of Modern Art, did a retrospective of his work. And here's a picture of the retrospective. This was a year before Matisse died, and they asked Matisse to pick out his favorite works. And you can see our painting in MoMA at this exhibition. So Matisse picked this out as one of his most favorite paintings. So let's talk about it a little bit. Well, I think we'll go to the next slide, so we'll get a little bit better of a picture of it. Well, first of all, here's the exhibition catalog from the MoMA in 1951, showing the Matisse. And let's go to our picture of the painting next. So why is this so important? This was painted in 1918 when Matisse was escaping the northern France, where World War I was still raging on, and went to southern France, went to Nice. He painted with Renoir. Renoir was painting the same scenes, and Renoir got really mad at him because he said, "I don't understand how you, at such a young man, understand light so much better than I do, and I've been painting for 70 years." And so he paints this. This is a village in Nice, and the road going up, and it's just big, and it's peaceful, and it's wonderful. So here's a painting that's never left the family besides to go to the museums. Matisse picked it out himself for a retrospective that turned him into the superstar. It's been in 14 different international exhibitions and pictured in 13 different books. It just doesn't get any better than that. And then I'll show you other examples in museums. Here's one of Nice, the exact same period, nowhere near as pretty as ours in MoMA and Museum of Modern Art. Here's one in the Tate, nowhere near as pretty, a little bit earlier than ours. Here's one the exact same period in the Met. I think it's different than ours. I like it a lot. I prefer ours, but I still like that one a lot. Here's one in the Met from the exact same period, a little bit different, a lot different of a feel, but the same period when he was in Nice. So we have all these examples. Let me show you the size of the painting. You can see the scale of the painting here. It just has wonderful scale. It's beautiful. It's about, if you made a list of all the Matisse works, it's unequivocally in the top 5% large in size. So it has scale. You feel like you're there. So it's, to me, it's the best of all worlds. It's a completely private Matisse that had never been on the market, descended through his family's many examples in many museums. And this one itself has been in 14 different museums. It just doesn't really get any better than that.
Yeah, it's a fantastic piece. Definitely wall presence, if you see it here in the gallery and as displayed on here. One of the questions was, besides Renoir, who else influenced Matisse? So I guess from that quote that you mentioned of Renoir, they're wondering who else might have influenced Matisse at this time or throughout his life.
So I mentioned Van Gogh was probably the first artist to change, to move from the realistic paintings that were done in the academic, where everything was realistic, to a little bit less realistic, you know, a little bit slightly, just a little bit off. The two that came after him that really changed were Cézanne and Matisse. Matisse was heavily influenced by Cezanne. He was influenced by Gauguin, and he was influenced by Van Gogh. These were the three artists that Matisse loved more than anybody else. He loved Renoir too, of course, although Renoir didn't love him. It's really, it's art with a capital A.
That's so great. I want to encourage everybody, remember to use that Q&A box at the bottom of your screen to ask any other questions. And then we're going to try to have a section at the end here where we get to answer some of those. And we'll come back to the questions that are being asked on this one as well. But I just want to encourage everyone to continue to do that. We haven't forgotten you. It's just we want to definitely get to a few other special treasures. The next one is one of my favorite in the gallery, and it's a statue of David and Goliath. Bill, there's a lot to speak on this. So just share with everyone the story behind this one.
Wow. Okay. So, when we say museum quality, this may be an understatement for this one. So let me tell you the story. The highest honor that a French artist could ever hope to achieve was second half of the 19th century, certainly, was to exhibit at the Salon. So Musee, in 1872 Salon, exhibits the plaster of this. He has not made the bronze. He makes a full-size plaster, and the plaster wins the gold medal. Mm-hmm. And the state comes in and says, we would like to buy it. So the state comes in and says, we'd like to buy it. And what that means is that they want an exclusive. So they said, we will buy two of these from you, but you cannot make any more. So they buy two, and one of them, well, we can go to the next picture. There's George, who's in his much more casual, and standing next to the one in the Musée d'Orsay. When you walk into the Musée d'Orsay, it's one of the very first things you see. And George looks very casual there, standing next to it. The reason why George went is we had just bought ours, and I told George that he was going to France. I said, well, you got to go see it. He goes, why do I have to go see the David? I said, you'll see. Just go get a picture next to it. And so the timing turned out very well. So what makes this so special? We can go to the next pictures. This is close-ups of it. There's David's face where you can see the strength of it in Goliath's head. So in 1872, this was a really important moment. This was a really important moment in France's history. They had just lost the Franco-Prussian War, and they considered themselves now an underdog. So this sculpture comes up, and what's the greatest underdog story of all time? David and Goliath. Mm-hmm. It's a synonym for underdogs. And so this comes out, and it just resonates with the French people. So the French government buys two. One of them they put in the Musée d'Orsay, and the other one they put in front of the museum in Toulouse. This is the bottom of it where you can see the foundry mark on it. We can go to the next slide now. We're going to show the examples in the museum in a second, but I just want to finish telling the story because it's so fascinating. So they do two of them. So if they've said that you can only have two and that's it, how does the third one get made? There's one caveat to the rule that the artist can make one for himself as long as it was assured that it would never be sold during his lifetime. So Mercy makes the one we have for himself. So the only two examples of this are in museums, or you could say three if you include the plaster, which we're looking at right now. The only two that you'll see are in museums and ours. So there's three of them in the world, four if you include the plaster, and all the other ones are in museum and not ours. So the plaster is in the museum in Toulouse, France. Let's go to the next slide. Outside of the Museum of the Toulouse in France is the other one the French government bought. And then we go to the next slide. And in the Musée d'Orsay, their picture is better than the one George's wife snapped with her iPhone. Here's the one of the first things you see when you walk in the Musée d'Orsay. It doesn't get any better. This is the ultimate underdog story. And here's ours, all three exactly the same. Just extraordinary quality. Ours is better than the one outside of the museum in Toulouse, only because that one's been outside for 150 years. And, the weather's taken its toll. Ours has been inside in wonderful patina, and the one in the Musée d'Orsay is identical to ours. There's been a number of smaller reductions of this. much smaller. And if you want one that's, you know, 20 inches high, those are not what I would call rare, but there's only three bronzes in the world like this, and the other two are in museums. And I just love it.
Yeah, it's such a great, again, I was literally one of my favorite pieces. It makes such a presence when you walk into the Musée d'Orsay, and they have amazing collections, as you noted. And then here in our gallery, when you enter, it's one of the very first statues that you see when you enter our gallery. So it was a surprise, and a pleasant surprise at that, when I came back from France. I felt like I brought something with me at that point. So when the next treasure that we're going to be talking about is this ancient Greek terracotta goddess. Now, this is something we felt when you walk through a museum, you see sculptures like this throughout. And so I'm excited for you to share just what makes this one special and this field of objects like this.
So this is terracotta, and it was carved in Toronto, Italy, somewhere around 400 BC. Obviously, it could have been 410 BC, 390 BC, and it's a classic female head. These are exceptionally rare, and this one is exceptionally rare. That reddish color in there is still the original paint. A lot of people don't realize this, but all these sculptures, including the marbles that you see, were all painted in ancient Rome and ancient Greece. But the paint never lasts. This one, for some reason, has lasted. I'm sure it was buried, and that's why it has lasted. Let's go to the next slide, and we can see its scale. You can see it's basically a life-size head, maybe slightly smaller than life-size. We have side views next, I believe. Yeah, here are the side views of it. I love things like this. So when we talk about museum examples, let's go to the museum examples. Here's one almost identical to ours in the Met. Her left side of the face is not as pretty as ours. I think there's another one in the Met. Similar feel, a good same color hair. Quite nice. I don't think the face, I think the face is actually a little bit spooky. Keep in mind those eyes that look, you know, they would have been painted with eyeballs. Here's one in the J. Paul Getty. All from the exact, you know, all from the Toronto region. Here's one in the museum, and I'm not going to even try and pronounce the name of this place in Greece. The Archaeological Museum in Greece. And here's ours. It's just, this is a museum piece that would have been in a temple. It would have been in a pantheon. I mean, it would have been in a really important place. And if you think of the high point of ancient Greece, you know, with Sparta and Athens, 400 BC was it. And, you know, this was when Greece was at its power around the world, when the Greek Empire was the biggest empire of the world. And, you know, this was the most important place. And it's an extraordinarily rare example. And almost all the other examples like this are in museums.
Great. So we did get a couple of questions from our viewers on this one. One of them I'd like to, I guess we can answer now, is how can you tell the time, I guess the period in which it was made? You said 400 BCE, 410 BCE, you mentioned earlier.
Well, no. First of all, you can't tell if it's 400 BC or 410 BC. You know, we write circa because it's a decent range. Styles changed. I mean, heads were made at a certain time and styles changed. You know, think about, you know, you might buy a car, you know, you're going to buy a car in 20 years from now or 10 years from now, they're going to look a little bit different. Styles change. Cars certainly look different than they did 40 years ago. Styles changed. But Toronto was the king of head making for only about 40 or 50 years. And then we don't know why they stopped making it. We don't necessarily know why. It's possible they ran out of the clay. It's possible somebody came in with cheaper prices. It's possible, you know, the head man in Toronto pissed off the head man in Sparta and says, okay, we're not buying anymore. I mean, we don't know, but they basically quit making them. And so styles change. But you can test the age on these with carbon testing and get a very good range that it is a period piece. Mm. It's not going to tell you it's 401 BC, but it will tell you it was made between, you know, 370 and 430 BC when you look at that. So it's a pretty easy thing to date.
Another question on this was the earring holes. So did these have earrings?
They did have earrings. I've never seen a pair with, many of them did.
Okay.
But they would have typically been gold earrings. So if right. that would have been the first thing that would have been plundered by somebody taking it off, oh, the head's worth nothing, but you know, let me take the earrings. I've never seen one with original earrings. I'm sure there's some that exist in some museum somewhere, but I've never seen it.
Right. That's fantastic. And we do have more questions that we'll try to get to at the end on this one. But I'd like to move on to another great bronze that we have here that you can see when you enter the gallery. And you're going to tell them all about why this is museum quality. This is an equestrian portrait of Louis XIV. Bill, share with us your insight on this one.
So every bronze you've ever seen like this of a leader, George Washington, King George, Napoleon, you name it, were all based off of this sculpture. This was the quintessential first sculpture ever done of the ruler, of a monarch, of a ruler on a horse. And it was all about power. And Louis XIV was trying to show how much power he had. He had Girardon had this made to put in Place Vendôme. Place Vendôme, if you that's where the Ritz was for some of you that you know that Lady Di ate her last meal and then left. But it's also where a statue of Napoleon is right now. But Place Vendôme was the center of the culture of Paris. This sculpture was made for the center of it, and it was huge and it was important. Let's go to the next slide. You can sort of get its idea of scale. Now, the original was far, far larger than this. Let's show the picture of the original. Here's a picture of it. It doesn't exist. Why doesn't it exist? It stayed up for less than 100 years. During the French Revolution, they obviously didn't want any more kings. They took it down and they melted it down to make cannonballs. And only one small part of it remains. We go to that. And that's the foot of Louis XIV, his left foot, and that's in the Louvre. So the foot of the original is the only part, and that's in the Louvre. We go back to our next picture. It's hard to, every single thing is symbolic on here. First of all, he's dressed in a Roman toga. So he's comparing himself to Julius Caesar and the Roman emperors. If you notice, he doesn't have a saddle. The horse listens to his command. Everything is under Louis XIV's control. Mm-hmm. Everything here is symbolic. Look at his flowing hair. Every bit about it is just completely symbolic. And these sculptures made, you know, look at the horse's tail. It's perfect. It's, you know, it's obeying everything about it. Wanted to show the power of Louis XIV. And it's considered the greatest equestrian sculpture ever made. Sadly, the only existing models of this are the models that were made by Girardon, which we have one of them. And I'll show you where some of the other ones are. This is in a place called the Louvre, same size as ours. Next one, this is one in the Royal Collection Trust, which is the King's collection. The base on that was made in England about 1815 or 1820 after Napoleon was deposed, and so it's an English base holding up Louis XIV. The next one, in the State Hermitage Museum in St. Petersburg. There's a couple more in other museums, but I guess if the Louvre and the King's collection and the Hermitage aren't good enough, well, we're not going to please you tonight. Here's ours. You can sort of see the detail a little bit better in this picture. It's just an extraordinary sculpture, and to have something that all of its mates are museums and the foot of the original is in the Louvre, because that's all that remains, is really impressive.
Yeah, this is such a great bronze. The detail is amazing. And like I said, a great presence when you see it here in our gallery. Thank you, Bill, for sharing that. I know you could have spent much more time on this and the ones in the museum and the history behind it. We're big fans of Louis XIV and all his objects. So a couple months ago, you visited Japan, and I was very jealous of your trip. You were able to see some of my favorite things, like samurai suits of armor and weapons. And we were able to acquire this beautiful, complete Edo period samurai suit of armor. Bill, I know you can probably spend a whole webinar on just speaking to all the details on this, but give us a little insight into why this one is so special.
I was really lucky. Before I went to Japan, I, of course, tried to do as much homework as I could. I hadn't been there in many, many, many years. And a friend of mine told me, he said, a friend of his had two extraordinary suits of armor, and he may want to sell them. And I was very fortunate. The U.S. dollar was an historic high. Well, from a buying power standpoint, it was higher than it had been in 50 years. The dollar had been stronger against the Japanese yen, but Japanese prices were much higher. Japan had many years of deflation. So I went there at just a fortuitous time. I didn't plan it that way. It just worked out that way. And I got into this gentleman's house and I bought this suit of armor. I will tell you that this suit of armor sold, but I've just bought the other suit of armor, which we don't have here yet. And the other one is a similar one. So let me give you a little, I don't want to bore you with, we could talk the whole seminar about this one. And I won't, I promise. I just need to give you a little bit about Japanese history. For roughly 1,000 years, from 500 AD, 600 AD into the 1600s, Japan was known as the Warring States. The reason why is that there was no unification of the country. There were these warlords that owned parts, and there were constant battles between the samurai. And the samurai were the ruling and the warrior class. And this is really important because there were many, many, many battles. And then in the 17th century, a warlord by the name of Tokugawa, descended from one of the most famous clans, unified Japan for the first time. And he created what was known as the Edo period. We'll get to that in a second. And everybody said, well, this is not going to last. We've had wars for 1,000 years. Well, it did last. Before China was invaded, before Korea was invading, this time it lasted. And it was the very first time that it did last. And so the suits of armor that were made from this period were the best suits of armor ever. Why? Two reasons. Three reasons. First of all, technology was better. So they were just a little bit better made than the early ones. Second of all, the early ones, people kept saying, well, hell, the people from Kyoto are going to be invading us in the next 3 weeks. I need a suit of armor. I need it quick. So there wasn't that much time to make a great one. And the third reason was most of those were in battle. So they had scars and dings and replacement pieces. And so they just, a great example, just are very, very seldom come along because they needed to make them quick. Well, all of a sudden during the Edo period, people had time to make it. They weren't worried that somebody was going to invade them in 2 or 3 weeks. They said, take your time, make it. They still believed they were going to use it because they still believe. So this is a working suit of armor, which we'll go into in 1 second. But they had time to do it right because there were no rush. Let's do some close-ups of it just so you can see it. The face over there is made of Japanese lacquer. Excuse me. Look at the helmet. The helmet's really important. That showed who the person was. This was the leader of the clan. The soldiers wanted to know that their leader was there. So he had his symbol, his mark on there. Not unlike the flag of Napoleon or another general saying, hey, I am here. Go to the next slide. You can see the chain link mail, on the arm, but you can see how it all moves and it's all flexible. The metal and rope in between. So it would stop arrows. It would stop a sword if it hit it, but it was still completely flexible. I think we have one more slide after that. Yeah, you can see. It's hard to describe, but those cords in there are intertwined all the way through. So if one of them got cut, it didn't fall because it stayed there. So it was just like in jeans. And that's the original rope that's on there. Look at the decoration. Who needs decoration like this on their suit of armor? I mean, it's a military piece, but this was somebody showing, hey, I have all the money in the world and I'm really, really, really important. I think we have one more picture, which is the back. Here's the back of it, how it all comes together and you can sort of see the flexibility. Look at the box that it's sitting on. That's the original box that you would have stored it on. I mean, the fact that it has its original box is amazing. The person had something that was really cool. I won't expect you to read it. This is a certificate from the Japanese Arm and Armor Research and Preservation Society. It's stating that it's all original. That's something you rarely see, that, you know, that it's not a hodgepodge of parts. We have a very short video of it. I think it's just a few seconds to be able to see it. And you can sort of just, I wish you could see it moving, but that would be too wonderful. You know, the design on the helmet, the bearskin feet, it's just so cool. I mentioned the Edo period. Before this period, the power laid it in Kyoto. And that's where the emperor lived. Well, for the first time, the power became with the shogun. Tokugawa came, the first shogun, he moved to Tokyo. Edo was known as Tokyo then. Tokyo was known as Edo then. And so it became the Edo period. It was a period when the power of the ruling class was in Tokyo. And so this is an Edo period, 18th century suit of armor. So we've talked museum quality. Let's go to the next slide. Here's one of the Met, not quite as nice as ours, still quite nice, little bit later than ours, very similar headdress. Here's one, the Louvre Abu Dhabi. I love this one. It's really super, about the same age as ours. I love it. I think I like ours better, but I would be overjoyed if I owned this one too. Here's one in the Tokyo National Museum. I saw this when I was there. I love it. It's extraordinary. It's later than ours. It was so amazing. The next one is in another museum, which I saw in Tokyo. This is very similar to ours, a little bit later than ours, not quite. I love the breastplate on this one. Other things we have are nicer than ours. That breastplate on that was just amazing. And I think we have one more. Oh yeah, the Minneapolis Museum of Art. I've never seen this one in person. It looks wonderful. So when we talk about, you know, here's Mallory standing next to it, so you can get a scale. When you talk about these things, this is something that's really just, to me, it's so much fun, and it's from such an interesting period in Japanese history, and it's in perfect condition. This one is sold. Our other one, which we've just acquired, we have to go through an incredible amount of paperwork to get it out of Japan legally. I think it'll be in about 3 weeks or so.
That's fantastic. Some questions came in on this one from our viewers. I'd like to maybe hover on this one just for a couple more minutes, Bill. Jeff asks, what is the suit made of? So what are the different materials that are incorporated into the suit?
Well, let's see. I'm not going to mention everything. The feet are bearskin, keep you warm, but also bearskin is very tough. So, you know, it would impede an hour or so. It wouldn't necessarily stop it, but it would impede it. The face mask is Japanese lacquer, which we'll get to in a minute what that is. Not in this, because we have another piece coming up, museum quality. There's iron chainmail. The helmet is iron with 62 spikes in it. There's basically, you know, like thin pieces of gilded bronze that all flex. And then it has the original material, the original rope that holds it in. I know I'm missing some of the features in there and some of the pieces that hold it. There's just so many things on here that just make it extraordinary. And to have something original, I mean, I can't tell you. I imagine it was packed away in its original box for 200 years, and that's why it survived, which is amazing.
Yeah, it was so cool. A sad piece to see leave the gallery, but we're going to get back to these on some of the other questions that we're getting on the suit of armor, so we'll come back to these. But our next treasure here is a wheel lock rifle by Marcus Zellner. Quite literally, and you're going to explain this, quite literally, a museum quality treasure. Bill, share with us the details on this one.
So first of all, I need to tell you, of all the photographs we're showing tonight, this is my most disappointing, only because in a photography world, it's very hard to focus and show the detail of a gun that's this long and show the overall gun. It's just because there's so many details to it. This was made by Marcus Zellner. He was born in Salzburg, Austria, in 1693. This is a giant hunting gun made for somebody extraordinarily wealthy. Let's show a few of the details on the gun. This is the side plate. Look at the look at the striking mechanism that would strike, you know, all engraved. Those are hunting scenes down there. You can see the woods carved on the barrel. You can see the original gilding. You can see the stags on the left. That's gilded bronze on there. Look at the trigger. So you had a place to put your fingers to hold it. We go to the next picture. That's Circassian walnut. That's the same wood that is in the dashboard of a Rolls Royce. Look at the bronze in there. Look at the quality of the bronze that goes all the way around it. I mean, those are scenes. If you notice, it's hard to see, but there's a scene on the left, you know, on the bronze on the left, where they have just killed the boar and they're putting on the table to cut it open so they have dinner for the next month. I don't know how long a big boar lasts. We can go to the next picture. This is the back of the butt of the gun. I don't remember. That's a goddess of hunting, I mean, with a hunting dog, you know, so, you know, maybe may the gods worship you. So we talk about, you know, museum quality. So this is, our gun is number one of two. Why was it number one of two? These great guns, here's one, here's number two of two, the Mate Hours. And it's in a great museum in Lisbon. A hunter would have had two guns because they only shot one. They only shot a bullet and then take a while to reload. So why, if you were hunting, you would have had your servant with you. He would have held one gun. You would have shot it. And then if you didn't kill the thing, he would have handed you the other gun to get a second shot in while he was loading this one. So the very best guns came in pairs. The literal mate to this, not one like it, not one almost like it, not one very similar. Yeah. The mate to this, number two of two, and ours is one of two, is in the museum in Lisbon. So it really, you can't really get any more museum quality than have its twin brother in the museum.
A question that came in, I definitely want to make sure we answer, and don't forget this one. Would something like this be used in the field or just for an art display?
Oh no, this would have definitely been used for hunting. But it was going out, it's like if you had a Rolls Royce or a Ferrari you can use it for driving, but you know, it might be a little bit for showing off too, that you have that, you know, you have a car that's nicer than all the other cars down the block. And that's what it, I mean, it was definitely, it was way too good of a gun. It would have cost a fortune. You would have used this hunting, but it wasn't a battle gun. Could you have used it in battle? Of course you could. Of course you could, but this was made for hunting, and with the long barrel, it was much more accurate. Because the balls that they put in there were not completely round, so they would move around. So the longer the barrel, the more likelihood that the bullet would go straight.
That's fantastic. And yeah, I can see this over a mantle. You'd have to display something this beautiful.
Oh, so. No, you would have, you, this wouldn't have gone in the gun safe. This would have been over a mantle and saying, you know, look at my guns, you know, I have the best pair of guns you'll ever see.
Yeah. Fantastic. Okay. We're going to jump back into something related to your previous trip here with this Japanese lacquer box. So the face mask on the samurai suit of armor had lacquer, and you said you were going to discuss it, and I knew why, because this one was coming up. But there's a big story behind this one as well. So Bill, share with us the details on the lacquer box.
Okay, so let's see. Okay, M.S. Rau, we've been in business 111 years, and we have owned many pieces by the kings of England and by Napoleon, not many, but you certainly a few in the kings of France, and we've owned things that were in the White House and owned by, you know, George Washington and Abraham Lincoln and so forth. And one thing that we have never owned and or actually really remember ever seeing for sale is something that was made for the Emperor of Japan. You know, this is the longest reigning monarch in the world. There's just things that just don't come around. Well, this is a box made for the Emperor of Japan. It was made for the Emperor Taisho. And he made it for a very important, I'll tell you now. He made it for a very important reason. He made it to celebrate his ascension to the throne when he became emperor and when he became quote unquote a god. And he made it for his son, Hirohito, who became emperor and was the famous Japanese emperor that was somewhat guilty in starting World War II and very instrumental in bringing Japan back from the horrors of World War II. So he, very much of a yin and yang there. So he, this was made for an emperor as a gift to the future emperor. It was made, we put circa 1915, it was made between 1914 and 1915. We know that, which we'll get to in a minute. Now you can't really, it's scale. It's probably 14 inches, 15 inches long. I want you to see the quality. There you can see a scale, which is wonderful with the apple. Look at the quality of it. Now, it also has something that you only see on imperial pieces. That's a chrysanthemum on the top. That was basically the crown. That was a symbol of the Japanese emperor. So that could have only been made for the Japanese emperor or the imperial family. But every bit about it, this is wonderful. But let me explain lacquer. Here, you can stop there for a second. Let me see if I can explain the lacquer. This is like layers and layers and layers of the very thin fingernail polish. And it would have taken at least a year to make, where they put a layer on, let it dry, put a layer on, let it dry until they build it up and then use actually pure gold dust on there to make the design. All four sides of it are decorated. The top is decorated. I think we can go to the next picture. The inside of the lid is decorated. So how do we know who it's made for? We can go to the next picture. It's hard to see, but this is the inside cover of its original box with its original silk. That's a wood box that's underneath the silk. This came in its original box, and in there it says the date and when it was made for, and that it was made for the emperor to give to the other Taisho, and there was only one other Taisho male at the time, and that was Hirohito, so we know it was made for the future emperor. He had had two brothers, but they had predeceased him in 1915. So he was the only, Hirohito was the only male it could have been given to. And so here we have the original box made for the emperor, for a gift for the other emperor, with its original silk in there in perfect condition. And we mentioned it's museum quality. We can go to the museum examples. Here's one made by the same maker who made ours, Kanawobi Icho. He was head of the Imperial Workshop, and you can see these are two made by him in a museum in Kyoto, very similar with the chrysanthemums on it. And those are in the museum in Kyoto. We go to the next one. Here's a similar one. It has semi-chrysanthemums on it. This is the Met. Not quite the same as ours, not as big as ours, quite beautiful, but not as nice as ours. This is similar to ours. This is in Versailles. It's a little bit more artistic, but this was not necessarily imperial. Find even in museums, this, the Met has something that's similar, and the museum in Kyoto has almost the exact same thing. That's it. These aren't out there anywhere. And it's the only example like this that I have ever seen for sale. And we were so pleased to buy. And when I saw this and the condition was in, which was mint perfect. So a lot of pieces, I wouldn't say Japanese lacquer is fragile. It's quite hard, but if you drop it or if you hit it hard, it will chip or break. So a lot of pieces that were made in the 18th and early 19th century, they were in favor, and then they became out of favor. In 1940, somebody looked at you and said, why do you want that? Why, George, why are you still wearing bell-bottom jeans? The 1970s was a long time ago. Get rid of that polyester shirt, dress up in something normal. They gave away those clothes and they just wasn't taken care of. This was taken care of because this was the emperor's box. So however it left the family, we don't know. But when it did, whoever had it cherished it, because it said on there, made for the emperor, for the next emperor, and with the date and why it was made. And so it was always cherished, and because it was cherished, it's still in mint condition.
Just absolutely lovely. You saw a scale shot there, but being able to see the details is just incredible in person. So I recommend if you're ever in Orleans and it's still available, to come see it. Our next museum quality treasure is this Roman Empire table. And we put many things on social media now, TikTok and Instagram. And sometimes we joke around, what's going to go viral per se. We did not expect this one, Bill. There's a huge interest in this Roman Empire table. And please just share your story about it and why you think it has just caught the fascination of so many of our viewers.
Well, let's start with museum quality. This is better than any example in any museum. I would show you some other museum ones, but this is better than that. So we call it a table, but the reality is it's not. This was originally a pavement. And it was originally a Roman pavement, and it would have been made for someplace extraordinarily important. It would have been made for someplace like the Senate or a major temple. You know, this is something Emperor Constantine would have walked on. It would have been played for a great important place. And how do we know that? Let's go to the next slide. You see this slide. This is the top. Those marbles that you see right there, these came from all around the Roman Empire. So when they were walking on this, they were saying, we own the world. They came, where did they come from? Of course, they came from Italy. They came from Greece. They came from Turkey. They came from Egypt. They came from Northern Africa. They came from Spain. They went the whole circle of the Mediterranean. The person who was walking this was saying, we own the world and we're walking on it. The porphyry on there, the red from Egypt, that had been extinct for 500 years. That would have been taken. That's number four, if you're depending on how big your screen is. That would have been taken from like an ancient obelisk that had been maybe broken and fallen down, and they had taken that to make it. So, I mean, this was them showing that we control the world. So imagine a pavement like this. It's 3rd century AD, so, you know, 250 AD, which is just extraordinary. And it's, I would say it's unbreakable. I mean, it's to me, because it was made to be walked on. We go to the next picture. There it is on its base. Now, the marbles on the bottom were done in the 19th century, and they were designed after a very famous scene. Oh, I think we have a slide of it from the Vatican. That's a very famous sculpture that's in the Vatican. These were taken from that and made to raise the table. I call it the greatest outdoor table of all time because nobody would steal it. It would be an impossibility. It took us 12 men to lift it up to put it up top. So you could put it outdoor, it'd be unbreakable. The tree falls on it, the tree breaks, it doesn't. But obviously it could be used indoor. I think it's the greatest dining table that we've ever had, even though it wasn't born that way. I'm going to show you some examples in some museums. This is, I mean, the Met, you know, mosaic pavements that they have. It doesn't even compare. We can go to the next one. This is the same period. These are not marbles. These are like little tiles that were made. This is in Canterbury. Really beautiful. Non-portable because they're tiles. I mean, this was put into the ground like that. Beautiful, but not marbles. This is a great example of also small pieces, not marbles. That's in the British Museum. Stunning piece. You can see it's missing a whole bunch. That red that's around there are pieces that are missing, but that's because it's small little pieces, no marbles like ours. The British Museum, the Vatican Museum has these are mosaics. This is getting like ours, but it's a 5-inch piece. Ours is 7 feet long. It's beautiful, but it's not like ours. And this is a wonderful piece. That's quite lovely and similar to ours. It's about one quarter of the size of ours. And this is a museum in Georgia. And that's probably the closest to ours. It doesn't compare to ours. It's beautiful. I'd love to have it. It's at the museum in Emory. But ours is just something that's, I mean, it's just amazing. And to think, you know, when somebody's walking, we own the world. And, you know, this sort of proves it because I'm standing on it. I don't think it gets any better than this.
So one of the questions came through. I thought maybe just to pose this, you may not know 100%, but why make it a table? I mean,
why not? I mean, I think it took something it just sits on those things. It's not attached. If you said, I'm building a house and I want this in my walkway, that would be great. But this is something that it becomes usable. I mean, don't get me wrong. If I was building a house, well, no, I would still use it as a table because I would love to eat at this table. But would it be like the coolest thing in the world to put on, to put in the front in your foyer and walk on and have that when you see that? I think it would be just, I think it would be awesome. You know, there's, you know, you could hang it on a wall plaque if you had really strong walls and look at it that way. It's a piece of art. And however you chose to use it, it would be great.
That's great. All right, we have two more treasures to discuss. And these are...
George, let's skip this one only because I'm seeing the time is running. Yeah, let's go to the better piece of jewelry. So because we promised people an hour, and I don't want to keep them, especially ones on the East Coast that are getting really hungry.
Absolutely.
And I apologize that we're going to skip one, but I've been talking too much.
So I'm glad you noticed the time. I was totally mesmerized here.
So this is something that's really, I love. This piece of jewelry would have been one of the most expensive pieces of jewelry ever made. It would have been one of the most expensive pieces of jewelry ever made in the 19th century. Let's show the scale shot. So here's the scale shot to give you an idea how big this is. There's 200 plus carat of diamonds in there. Now, I want to put this in perspective. In 1840, when this was made, all the diamonds of that size known in the world could have easily fit into one normal size bathtub. Now, think about that. So think about what percent of the diamonds that was of the world's diamonds. And, you know, it would have cost a fortune to make. So why did somebody make this? Well, I'll tell you what, we have a video of it. It's just a few second video, but you'll see it and you'll see it sparkle. It has so much life to it. One of the beautiful things about curves is that when it's always going to catch a light, because when a curved piece of jewelry is worn, it's catching the light from whatever angle. It's going to catch a light from one of the angles. Here it is. So who was this made for? We've all heard the term, you know, that's like bringing beer to Munich or sand to the beach. The original term with it, that's like bringing coal to Newcastle. Mm-hmm. The Industrial Revolution that began in England was powered on coal, and coal came from Newcastle. And arguably, we don't really know this, you know, but many people say the richest people in the entire world were the Duke and Duchess of Newcastle. So the Duchess has a really important event. And so what would be considered in somebody's lifetime the most important social event to be invited to? And that was the wedding of Queen Victoria. Queen Victoria was her cousin. And here's a portrait of, I mean, a painting of the wedding. Of course, the Duchess is invited, and you know, it's not a bad thing to show up the Queen by having the Duchess, you know, the Duchess have her own brooch. She creates this Dutch brooch. In fact, we have a picture of her wearing it, not at the wedding, obviously. Here she is wearing it as the Duchess of Newcastle. You can see her wearing it. These were called stomacher brooches. You could wear it on the side of the breast, like we showed it earlier. You could wear it in the front. I'm going to show you another picture, her wearing it much lower. You could wear it, on your stomach. You could wear it on the side. You could wear it in different ways. I will tell you that the picture of her, the Duchess, as an older lady, sort of looks like my third grade teacher and scares the heck out of me. But that's neither here nor there. This is her when she was decked out later. When you arguably the richest person in the world, you can afford whatever jewelry you want. I want to give you another reason why this is so important. We can go to the next picture. Here's a Museum de Louvre. That bow brooch is slightly smaller than ours. It has the wonderful tassels, but it was designed after ours. Ours was the first in 1840. It's made, and then Emperor Napoleon III wants to buy one for his wife. So he has one designed with tassels. Well, the French Royal Crown Jewels, he loses, as we mentioned, the Franco-Prussian War on the Statue of David. He loses that and he gets deposed. And the French say, well, without a crown, there cannot be a king. Let's sell all the French crown jewels. The French sell all the jewels, including this one. Well, about 10 years ago, the Museum du Louvre locates this. And they raise money and they buy this back for roughly $10 million. I think it was $9.97 million. It was bought in euros, so there was an exchange rate to be able to buy back the Empress Eugenie's brooch, which is now hanging in the Louvre. Ours is the original of this. I love the tassels on this. This is the original box. If you see at the very top, it says Kathleen, Duchess of Newcastle. It's the best bow brooch in private hands. It's the original bow brooch. It was made for the wealthiest person in the world. And it just really doesn't get any better than that. And the mate to it that it was designed from is proudly pictured in the Louvre, and they paid roughly $10 million. Ours is much, 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 much less than that. But having said that, it just really doesn't get any better than this.
Fantastic. Well, Bill, thank you. We ran through a lot. And look, it was my job to keep you on track. You kept me on track by going past that one piece. So thank you for doing that. I was just enjoying it. And I know as many of our viewers, this is going to be the time where we do a couple of Q&A questions that I share with you here. So, Bill, the first one that I have for you, the samurai suit of armor. Do we know who the maker was?
We do. The maker signed it. I don't remember the maker's name, but we do know who made it. It is signed, and we know who it was made for. We don't know the person's name. We know he was the head of the clan, and it was a clan. It was the most exclusive clan of samurai that you had to pay it a fortune to join to each year to belong to this clan. He was ahead of that. When I say a fortune, somewhere it's hard. It was about in bushels of rice, but using buying power of a bushel of rice, it was equivalent of $20 million a year to belong to this clan. That's an expensive club to belong to. And he was head of it.
That's great. The other question that came in was the brooch. Is it heavy?
It's wearable. It's wearable. You wouldn't wear it on the thinnest silk dress. It's definitely wearable. It's to own arguably the best, maybe the best piece that will ever be in private hands, again, made in the 19th century, made for the wealthiest person in the world to wear to the most important social event that she would ever go to, the wedding of Queen Victoria. I don't know. It doesn't get any better than that. And it is wearable. I mean, and I know that because half the females in our gallery have worn it. And
yeah, I have
it. Brooch, and then Mallory's over there. Well, I have it on right now. So
this one came in during the lacquer box. Do they make this quality today for the lacquer box?
That's a really good question. The great majority of these things, I would say no. Lacquer is not a lost art in Japan. When I was there, I went to there's a city called Kawasawa, and about 3 hours north of there is a place where lacquer trees came from and lacquer came from. I went there to actually go see them make new lacquer and so forth. They make things that are probably 75% as good as this, which in most things you would say is just okay. And this is so extraordinary, it's still very good. Now, the crazy thing is, if this was made new today, not made for the emperor, if this was made new today, and you made one of this scale, and you made it 75% of this, the price would be much more than we're asking for this one, because labor costs are so high. But it's not a lost art, it's a dying art, because they worry that but there's so much pride in Japan over craftsmanship. It's one of the few things that are still being made that I would say are equivalent to some of the ones that were made in the 18th and 19th and early 20th century.
Very cool. I mean, just again, when you see the detail in person, it's astonishing. The question came in on the David earlier. When you spoke about it, the plaster piece didn't have a sword. So the question was, what happened to the sword with the plaster mold? I mean, we don't know, right? It could have broken off.
It plaster soft, and obviously it broke. And it probably didn't break in one piece. You know, it probably broke in eight pieces, and they didn't display it. The sword was there, of course. There it is. You can see it's missing a sword. The sword was there when it was displayed in the museum in 1870, but sometime since 1870, the sword has probably been shattered. You can, if you look at the base of it, you can see chips on the base. You know, I mean, it's plaster. Plaster is inherently weak. And so, if you know, unlike, you know, the lacquer, if you hit the lacquer really hard with the palm of your hand, it won't break. You hit that sword really hard with the palm of your hand, it would have broke. So that's, we don't know what, I don't know when it broke, but obviously it did have the original sword and it's broken and gone. Thankfully ours still does, but ours is bronze. So it's
bronze is a little bit harder, right? So with the Louis XIV statue, was the armor and hair typical of that period?
I didn't understand the question.
From the Louis XIV statue, was he wearing like the armor that they wore during that period, or?
Oh no, no! It was all symbolic. It had been scenes of like you know, with the fleur-de-lis showing France, and it had been his coat of arms. It wasn't like a suit of armor that you think of in Meantime to protect yourself. This was, I am the king, and I am, you know, it's hard to see. Can't really see it. It was, he would have had an armor, but it would have been all decorative, and he was showing off. It was not, this okay. would not have been like the samurai suit of armor that was really meant to be used in battle.
He didn't go into battle with that beautiful head of hair plugged away like that. And okay, our last question that I just want to address with the samurai suit of armor, the helmet, how heavy was it, and what is the U shape, the metal portion, I guess.
The U shape was part of the coat of, think of a coat of arms, a European coat of arms, you know, that was their coat of arms. They wanted to know, the person who had this wanted everybody to know who he was. When he would have showed up with his soldiers, and when your leader showed up, that meant he wasn't scared. He was there to fight too. So this would have been all part of his coat of arms, you know, and so somebody looking at this would have known who he was. Because if you're going to battle either for him or against him, you knew who you're fighting, and they would have known that he showed up. And that's, I can't tell you exactly, but you know, just like a European coat of arms where you'll have a lion and a crown and something else. That's exactly what this was.
Great. And one last question that came up from one of our viewers. Thank you, Jeff, for asking. What's Bill's favorite museum? I think I know the answer to this one, but Bill, which one, if somebody was gifting you a museum, which one would you take?
I guess if I had to be gifted a museum, I would take the Musée d'Orsay. Yeah. It's just my favorite. I love the Met. I love the Louvre. I love the J. Paul Getty. The Hermitage doesn't suck. But that quality of the workmanship, that's the stuff in the Musée d'Orsay, is probably my favorite. So if somebody wants to give me a nice present, Christmas is on the 25th of December this year. I would be honored to take the Musée d'Orsay. I'm just letting you know.
Bill, thank you so much for sharing all this, all your knowledge and information and the history and the details on these museum quality treasures. I really appreciate you doing that. And I want to thank everyone for joining us tonight. When you log out, you will be prompted to fill out a survey. Please do that, because we try to improve our webinars every single time that we do it. We're already thinking about the next one, which I'm sure is going to be exciting. So feel free to do that. If you have any questions we weren't able to get to, or information that you want on any of the treasures that you saw tonight, you can email me, george@msrau.com, and I'll try to get back to you or connect you with your sales consultant to make sure we answer all your questions. Bill, again, thank you for taking the time tonight, answering all those questions. It was a fun one. The time flew, as they usually do, and I appreciate you doing that for everyone.
My pleasure, and thanks everybody for watching.
All right, have a great night.